welcome to Power Talk Live. I'm your host, Jesse Blake. I'm joined by my co-host, as usual, Ralston Hyman. Of course, Power Talk Live, the program where we get to the heart of things. Of course, we start off with a look at several matters in the public conversation space in a segment we love to call The Bottom Line. Of course, Ralston Hyman, Jamaica's foremost economist, and host of Real Business here on Power 106 FM. Good morning, sir.
Morning, sir. How are you doing?
I'm excellent. Thank you so much for joining us on a Tuesday morning, as usual. So much to get to, Ralston Hyman. Firstly, though, of course, you had a number of discussions on Real Business this morning, one of which I noted was with Dr. Cliff Riley, Executive Director of the Scientific Research Council. And that was in relation to the role of science and innovation in bolstering economic activity and development. Could you just elaborate on the main points of that discussion?
Well, the discussion was sparked by the minister's recent comment. Record levels of economic activity, record levels of employment, but there's no correlation with GDP growth. So although we have these record levels of economic activity and employment, GDP growth is still lagging, still very weak. Mm-hmm. The problem is that the areas of activities are areas that add very little value to the Jamaican economy. So what we need to do is to add more value. In order to add more value, it means that productivity has to be increased. In order to increase productivity, we have to be spending more on science and technology, R&D. The global average for R&D spending is 2.5% of GDP. In the Caribbean, we are 0.7% of GDP.
Wow.
In Jamaica, we are 0.25% of GDP.
So that's the missing link
than the rest of the Caribbean. Wow. Jamaica's labor productivity is the lowest in the entire Caribbean over the last 18 years, minus 0.8%.
Wow.
So you cannot have accelerated GDP growth if productivity is declining. And productivity is a function of education and training, innovation, science and technology, research and development.
That one is clear as day.
Clear
right. as day.
Right.
And as soon as you quoted the figures in relation to the wider Caribbean as it relates to spending on science and innovation,
precisely.
I immediately saw the link between the lack of spending and the lack of growth in the area of
precisely.
Science and technology and innovation.
Precisely.
And the lack of labor productivity, for example.
Precisely. So that's a fundamental problem.
And productive efficiency.
Precisely. So that's a fundamental problem in the Jamaican economy which we have to solve. And that is why we had a conversation with Dr. Riley, as well as Tamar Nelson, who is the Chief Technical Director in the Ministry of Labor and Social Security with responsibility for the Jamaica Productivity Center. Those are the things that we need to be focusing on if we're going to improve the level of economic activity leading to value added and faster GDP growth.
Let's talk about faster GDP growth.
Yeah.
You have been a champion over the years of making that link between economic development and crime.
Yes.
Help our listeners to understand yet at another time where crime is at the center of public discourse at the national level. Help us to understand the nexus between economic growth and crime.
Well, crime is one of the things that is affecting productivity in the country. So if you look at what is happening, take for example, we have the state of emergency now, Southern St. Andrew.
Yes.
That's like the country's industrial belt. That area is already being locked down by the mismanagement of the road infrastructure projects. That is going to be locked down by criminality now. So if you look at that vast area, you will see that most of the firms down there, they close by 4 or 5 o'clock in the evening as people want to get out of the danger zone. You'll also see that many buildings which used to be productive in that area completely wasted at this particular point in time because of the criminality. So the numbers tell us that criminality is about 5-6% of GDP. When we add that with corruption, we're talking about $200 billion or 10% of GDP. GDP is 2.1 trillion, so 200 billion is 10%. So if we do not deal with this problem of criminality and corruption, we'll never have the kind of GDP growth. So there's a twin problems, weak productivity and criminality and corruption holding back the Jamaican economy big time.
Wow. And you know, this morning, Ralston Hyman, here it is that for example, the Private Sector Organization of Jamaica, full disclosure on corruption needed, the PSOJ is asking or urging the government to make full public disclosure on the corruption scandals rocking the present administration.
Yes.
Now, I say that in the context of Vision 2030.
Yes.
That, for example, on Power 106, within the midday break, Vision 2030, making Jamaica the place of choice to live, work, raise families, and do business.
Yes.
If we cannot clamp down on corruption in a much greater way in Jamaica, that will be crippling our developmental progress and our developmental thrust.
Certainly, and that's what I'm telling you about the twin evils. As we said, that is 10% of GDP. If we could bring down, remember, there's a connection between corruption and criminality. You know? Because once you're corrupt, once you're in something that is corrupt, you can't go to the police to settle disputes. Mm-hmm. So the disputes have to be settled in a particular way. So that facilitates the criminality. So once you're unable to contain that, then you won't be able to grow GDP and to lead to the level of development that we have in the 2030 vision. So these things are things that are inescapable. We have to deal with them.
And not only disclosure.
No.
But closure.
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 So fix the problem. So those who must be sent away, must be sent away. Measures must be put in place to prevent it from happening again. But those who must be sent away, must be sent away.
Well, Sondheimer, I am, sometimes I am quite shocked, really, for lack of a better term, at the slow rate at which we get justice in Jamaica.
Precisely.
Are we talking about corruption and accountability, especially in government?
Right.
For example, you'll have, for like a Petrojam, for example, that was cited in the 2018 Corruption Perception Index by Transparency International.
Okay.
In the 2018 report, we're now in the greater part, we finished the greater part of 2019.
Yes.
And we are still in front of parliamentary committees, still waiting for a conclusion of the investigations, for example, by the Financial Investigation Division, which the PAAC chairman spoke about last week.
Right.
The slow rate of getting justice and having transparency in Jamaica.
That
it's
is,
so crippling.
Right, and that is one of the things that is fueling criminality in the country, because the justice system is so slow that people tend to take the law into their own hands. Now, if you look at the crippling economic effect, as you mentioned, Petrojam, energy is the most important ingredient in an energy-intensive economy.
Absolutely.
Energy is Jamaica's biggest import. Mm-hmm. You with me? So when we have that level of corruption in the energy sector, it's a big problem for the economy.
Mm-hmm.
Energy, $1.6 billion, the largest import item. The cost of energy, one of the biggest problems to efficiency and productivity in the economy. When we move now to the scandals at the Ministry of Education, education is one of the most important ministries in terms of transforming the economy. So when we look at what is happening at the Ministry of Education, you see that the economy and the country is dysfunctional. Because if we have that problem in the education ministry, that problem in the energy ministry, two of the most important ministries in relation to productivity, then you see why we are where we are and why these problems must be dealt with urgently if we are going to meet the 2030 vision. These are serious matters.
Very much so.
Yes.
Very much so. That, so much so that the University Council of Jamaica, now we're hearing in the news, is being urged to to install an acting president at the Caribbean Maritime University, for example. These are critical entities that we charge with ensuring that our future leaders are armed with the education and the training required to compete on an international level.
Scale. Precisely. And if we do not do these things, then we'll continue in the current direction where we see a whole lot of economic activity, low value-added activity, weak economic growth, massive trade and current account deficits, dependence on remittance flows, dependence on multilateral flows, despite all the advances that we have made on the fiscal side. These are very serious problems, and we need the cooperation of all sectors of society to deal with these problems.
Absolutely.
Yes, the corruption and the criminality and the weak productivity. Those are the most important things at this particular point in time.
Corruption, criminality,
weak productivity.
And weak productivity.
Walk hand in hand.
Hand in hand.
Yes.
All right.
Have to deal with those things.
Well, I'm so happy that you mentioned that, because, for example, in speaking with the National Security Minister last week, Friday, on Power Talk, he understood that, listen, more education spending will have to be done.
Precisely.
In order to bring about the long-term solutions that we need to bring down levels of crime and to increase economic growth as well.
And that's a point we were making 3 months ago when everybody was...
Only 3 months ago, that's
no, no, the, no, let me conclude. 3 months ago when everybody was cheerleading Minister Clark,
yes,
for that misallocation of resources when he gave away $14 billion to the high import content real estate sector, while the capital budget of the Ministry of Education was cut, when we still have schools on the shift system, which,
yes,
is giving us poor outcomes and producing the reserve army that is needed to fund the criminal army in Jamaica.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so those were the things we were talking about when we critique,
yes,
the allocation in the budget.
Yeah, and it's something that we actually spoke to with the National Security Minister. We placed a charge on him as well to possibly lobby the finance minister for more money for the education budget as well.
And that should not be necessary, because a prudent finance minister would see, look at the numbers in relation to productivity, look at the connectivity between the weak productivity and our inability to compete internationally, looking at the trade numbers, looking at the current account numbers, and would come to the conclusion that we must allocate more resources to education. We should have done the cost-benefit analysis to look and say, if we gave $14 billion to the high-import content real estate sector,
yes,
and if we provided $14 billion to the education sector, what would be the economic outcomes? A sound technician would have known that the Ministry of Education should have been allocated more resources, because the shift system and those systems, they are giving us the outcomes that we do not need. And they are helping to create that reserve army that goes into the criminality that is having such a deleterious impact on the economy. So if you look at it in relation to numbers, you'd have seen that it's a no-brainer that the Ministry of Education should have been allocated more resources, particularly on the capital side.
All right. Yeah. Well, the Minister of National Security took a trek to Montego Bay last week to,
yes,
see what's happening on the ground, because according to him, 70% of the boys that attend school in St. James, in troubled communities in St. James, drop out by grade 9.
Precisely.
And he wanted to, of course, see what could be done in terms of training and education,
yeah,
to minimize those numbers.
And why you believe he's looking that direction? Because he knows where they go when they drop out by grade 9. He knows where they go.
Absolutely.
Precisely.
Let's continue that,
right,
on the second half of the Bottom Line here on Power Talk Live on this Tuesday morning, right here on Jamaica News Network and on Power 106 FM. Welcome back to Power Talk Live on Jamaica News Network and on Power 106 FM. It's the second half of the Bottom Line here. Of course, we are joined in the Bottom Line by economist and host of Real Business on Power 106 FM, Ralston Hyman. Ralston, welcome back.
Thank you.
Now, before the break, we had spoken to what the minister conveyed last week.
Minister Chan.
Yes, that's right, the National, yes, Security Minister, during a trip to Montego Bay, yes, where he lamented that 7 out of 10 boys that enter high school drop out by grade 9,
yes,
in St. James. And one of the things that he spoke to as well was providing other areas of intervention, yes, for these young men,
yes,
who drop out of school. And one of the ways in which he spoke of intervention was through the establishment of automotive services training, yes, by the National Service Corps. Is the minister onto something in relation to training and for positive intervention for these young men who fall out of school so early?
Yes, I agree, because what we're saying is that the problem of criminality cannot be contained just by policing. So what we need education and training. We need social workers to go in. We need to look at the housing stock, because if you look at all the areas where we have these states of emergency, if you look at all the areas dominated by criminality, they have a particular look. Yeah? Broken down housing, poor fencing, poor sewage, whole lot of youths on the corner. Those are the characteristics. So you immediately, you recognize the need for training, the need for infrastructural upgrades, the need for a housing upgrade in these communities. So he's on to something.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to allocate more resources to those things. if we're going to deal with a problem in a lasting way. So if you send in the police for 2 weeks and then you extend it, and then housing stock remain the same, the sewage remain the same, the people in the community requiring training remain the same, you'll have to continuously go back there. You're not solving the problem. It's just a short-term public relations exercise and an expensive one too. Yes. So we need to put more resources at the core problems, and that is what the minister is talking about. So we're glad that he recognizes this. We want him now to lobby the other ministers so that they have more resources to do these things.
And when you think about where we are in terms of the money that we lose year over year in corruption.
Yes, and criminality.
My word, yes. We'd be so far ahead.
Precisely. If $200 billion.
We would be so far ahead, yes, in creating the positive intervention, precisely, that we need, in bolstering the amount of financial resources, yes, for the education, yes, programs, for the training, yes, programs, for the social, yes, development, for the infrastructure, precisely, development, for the better public
and
goods.
Have faster growth and collect more taxes, so it would be a win-win for everyone, rather than the zero-sum game that we have at this particular point in time. Hmm. Yeah.
Well, one of the areas in which we want to realize Vision 2030 as well is in the area of social equity.
Yes.
Ensuring that the various stakeholders involved in our economic puzzle and thrust, all of them are respected,
yes,
and given all the tools and facilities that they need to really be the optimal contributors to our economy and our country.
Yes.
You spoke to the, for example, the head of the Transport Operators Development Sustainable Services, Edgerton Newman, this morning.
Yes.
And I understand he sent a letter to the Prime Minister. Could, yes, you explain for us?
Yeah, but first let us explain to our listeners why this is important.
Yes.
Equity in an economy is important to economic growth. Why? Growth is driven by aggregate demand. That is total spending.
Yes.
Right? Now, if you are listening, you'll hear the authorities, the governor of the Bank of Jamaica, mm-hmm, and the finance minister himself, constantly refer to the weak aggregate demand. That's the weak total spending. Why is total spending weak? Because of the high levels of income inequality in the society. Jamaica is recorded internationally as having one of the worst levels of income inequality in Latin America and the Caribbean. Right. So the transport operators will tell you that they haven't received an increase over the last 7 years, despite the fact that everything that they use, the prices of everything that they used, have gone up. So they are saying that they discussed this with the minister, Robert Montague. They are tired of discussing this with him now. The last thing he told them was that he requested a study by the University of the West Indies to see whether they should get a fair increase, which is just total nonsense. So what they are saying now is that they are fed up. So they have submitted a letter to the Prime Minister outlining the urgency of that fare increase. They are awaiting a response from him tomorrow, and then they'll move to the next steps, because their members are saying, we just can't go any longer. 7 years without a rate increase, we are not managing. We cannot manage any longer. We have bills to pay. We have families. We have loans to service. We cannot manage any longer without this rate increase.
So I was just listening in on that discussion that you and Dr. Sutherland had with, yes, Mr. Newman, and one of the points that he brought up, for example, was that we have tried 14 meetings.
13 with the minister.
13 meetings, yeah, with the minister.
Yes.
And when they say to him, sir, we really need an increase, yes, he says, that's out of my remit. It's, yes, a transport authority that grants increases. I, yes, think the operators know that.
Know that. Right? They know that too. They know that he was telling them nonsense when he told them about the University of the West Indies.
Hmm. They offered solutions as well to their, yes, own challenges, and that's something we must applaud from them,
precisely,
as well. Not only are you speaking of the problems that you're facing,
yes,
but you analyze those problems and come up with solutions for said problems.
Yes, for example, the indiscipline.
Yeah.
They say that they're willing to pay $1,000 more in terms of their fees in order to facilitate a training program for their members, because they, oh, recognize the problem in relation to indiscipline. And they're also saying that the minister is facilitating that indiscipline when he opens up the system to more licenses, no fare increase, mm-hmm, and then we have this kind of rat race that we see taking place on the road. So they're also saying that public policy is responsible for the indiscipline, but nevertheless, they are willing to undergo the training at their own cost.
Wow.
Yeah.
So they are willing for an increase in their licensing fees.
Yes, just to facilitate the training program.
And that could easily be done because, of course, you would have one collectorate for all those increases.
Precisely.
Yeah.
And they have volunteered for the increase. So mm-hmm. here's it that we have a group that is volunteering for an increase in their license fees
yes.
to facilitate the training of their members.
Wow.
Yeah, but they're saying that they'll have to go to the Prime Minister with these things because they really can't work with this minister in relation to those things again.
But that's a low-hanging fruit, though, Rasta. Yeah,
that's the point.
And another low-hanging fruit is the whole idea of parking yeah. for them, for example, in Halfitree.
Precisely.
Yeah.
Now, we know of that former Ministry of Housing Construction building, which is a sore eye in Halfitree. They are saying...
And takes a lot of space.
Precisely. They are saying they are willing to work with the government to use a part of that as a parking space in Halfitree. That would do a whole lot to ease the congestion in Halfitree. And that would help the government to efficiently utilize an asset that is not being utilized. It is such a sad thing to see that building in Halfitree not being utilized, that former building of the Ministry of Construction and Housing.
Yeah.
Now, part of the remit of the Leaching Committee was to increase the efficiency of the utilization of the country's assets. That's a big asset, that's a prime asset in Halfitree.
And that could lend a lot to centralizing operations, precisely. Restoring a lot of public order
precisely.
In that central district.
Point.
Absolutely.
So that's a no-brainer. Yeah, so they have good suggestions. But they say they'd have to take these things to the Prime Minister because this minister, they can't deal with it anymore.
That's sad.
Yeah.
And is that a microcosm for the rate at which we go about conducting business in Jamaica?
And that's part of the problem. We are moving too slowly to do the things which should have been done a long time ago. So what we're seeing is that the international community is moving further and further away from Jamaica. Because while we are here wasting time, the international community is moving away. One of the things that we'll see tomorrow is that investors,
mm-hmm.
all eyes will be glued on Jerome Powell, the chairman of the Federal Reserve Board, tomorrow when he testifies. Because investors want to find out, is it that we're going to see a rate reduction? Because many investors believe that the global economy is slowing down dramatically under the misguided policies being pursued by the Donald. The trade war between the US and China is now bringing India in the picture. The European Union slowing down is also bringing them in the picture. That is having a slowing effect on the global economy. Now, economies like Jamaica will be required to build their resilience in this economy. So we see India. India grew by 5.8% during the first quarter. And Mr. Modi is under pressure because the people are saying this is a five-year low. We want to get back to 7.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, we are talking about 1.5 and saying, oh, buzz of economic activities and we are satisfied. We need to get going. So these things must be sorted out quickly because those are some things. The IDB tells us that. The clogging up of the roads with all of these cars and nowhere to park is one of the major factors leading to the low levels of productivity in the Jamaican economy. So the transport sector must be fixed if we're going to raise productivity. So transportation, education, criminality, corruption, those are the things that are holding back the Jamaican economy, and we must fix them if the economy is going to go forward.
Of course, our economy operates within the context of the regional economy.
Yes.
The heads of government meeting of CARICOM
yes.
last week, CASTRES,
yes.
and one of the points coming out, the establishment of a Caribbean private sector organization.
Yes.
Also as well, I saw in the paper today, sort of a manifest destiny type of declaration coming out of that heads of government meeting, that the region must come together in terms of being a more robust collective body to lobby on the region's affairs.
But that was what the founding fathers intended in the Treaty of Chaguaramas, yeah? What we have done is to turn the thing in a talk shop, and what we're seeing is that the global crisis now makes it imperative that we get down to that granular level, or we're not going to be able to survive in this environment, hostile trade environment.
I just find it mind-boggling that we're here dilly-dallying over what we need to do as a collective
precisely.
Body when there are so many things happening in the 21st century
precisely.
International economy.
Yes, that makes that imperative. If we don't, we're going to have a significant problem.
Wow.
Yep.
All these and more on the bottom line on Power Talk on JNN and Power 106 FM. Of course, we endeavor to provide you with information that you need to make critical decisions in your life. This is Power Talk Live, and of course we're looking at a very important issue. When we come back, we should be speaking with the opposition spokesperson on national security. He's Fitz Jackson. The latest state of emergency declared for St. Andrew South. There are calls for even more states of emergency. But is that all we need to tackle crime in the 21st century Jamaica that we live in? We'll hear from Mr. Jackson right after the break. Welcome back to Power Talk Live, a simulcast on both TV and radio. TV being Jamaica News Network and radio being Power 106 FM. And what a pleasure it is to have with us now the opposition spokesperson on national security. He is Mr. Fitz Jackson in our studios here at Broadcast House. Good morning, Mr. Jackson.
Good morning, gentlemen, and good morning to your many listeners.
Absolutely.
Is it all of Jamaica and across the world?
Yeah, we're international, sir.
That's what I was told.
Yes, sir. Indeed. We invited you in studio, Mr. Jackson, for discussions on a very important matter. Yes, of course, the ongoing fight against crime in Jamaica. Of course, the state of emergency announced last Sunday by the Prime Minister for the St. Andrew South Police Division. First of all, your initial reactions.
Well, the murder levels and shootings, and I like to twin both, because every shooting is a near murder.
True.
Right?
Okay.
And so I love to twin both of them together. The numbers have been increasing as the data indicated. So it's not a point that one just suddenly arrive at.
Yeah.
You have been gradually getting there.
Mm-hmm.
And nothing has been done to stem that gradual increase. And what that confirms is that outside of a state of emergency is a no response, is a no effective response.
Mm.
And the data and the increase in numbers in there, other areas like Clarendon and so forth,
yeah,
points to it. What is happening is that more persons are being killed, more persons are being shot, and more persons are living in greater levels of fear. The people in those areas, mm-hmm, get up and go to their beds at nights in fear,
mm-hmm,
those who happen to remain alive.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing else has been done. And the only response is the state of emergency. It becomes difficult to say, don't do this one thing, since you are not doing anything and the people are continuing in that level of fear. We have advanced, the opposition, from over the past 2 years, and I'm going to continue to say the same thing because it hasn't changed.
Yes.
There are some high crime areas, call them hotspots, as you may, throughout the country.
Yeah. Okay.
We said, prioritize the attention on those areas. Put together a task force equipped with the primary elements that can put a handle on it. One, focus your intelligence gathering capacities in those areas because you want to identify the persons who are perpetrating the murders and the shootings,
yeah,
in those areas. You can't lock up anybody unless you can identify them.
And that shouldn't be hard.
And I come back to that element of it in a moment.
Mm-hmm.
Two, provide the legal support to work alongside your intelligence gathering investigative team. Why? Because when you apprehend persons, you want to make sure that the cases you are put together can hold up in court.
Yeah. Very important.
Right?
Very important.
And I'll come back to that in a moment.
Yes.
If you look at the clear-up rate for murders, and you look on the conviction rate, there is an average clear-up rate of roughly between 45% and 50%.
Yeah.
What that clear-up rate mean? For all those murders, only 45% or 50% of those the police are able to attach somebody to,
yeah,
to be charged.
Yes.
Only 50%. Yeah. So another 50% of the murders, there's nobody the
walk
police
freely.
Have identified as responsible for those.
Good.
That is alarming.
Yes.
But out of those 45 or 50% that you charge somebody for, the conviction rate is between 5 and 6%.
Wow.
Wow. Wow.
So that showed a weak investigative
process. So it tells criminal that your chance of being apprehended is very low.
Yes.
Your chance of being convicted is extremely low, right? So there's no deterrent effect from the security forces in that area.
Yes.
It's for that reason that the legal support, and we say employ lawyers.
Yes.
Employ good lawyers, experienced lawyers, mm-hmm. to work alongside investigators so that when they identify those persons, they have cases that can stand up in court, that you can get successful prosecution to lock up those persons mm-hmm. and lock them away. So you reduce the population of criminals. Now, we have been told by many research, I'm not giving anything new, mm-hmm. that most of the murders are committed by gangs.
Yes.
If we can determine that the gangs are responsible for these murders, that obviously is our target, or ought to be our target.
Yes.
If you can cut down the level of murders by gangs, by targeting them, apprehending them, then you can drag the numbers down.
That's right.
And that's why we say focus there.
So tell our listeners, Fitz, give them the government's major objective, they say, of increasing economic growth and prosperity. Given the importance of stability and crime containment to prosperity, given all the research, why do you believe that the administration has been unable to do this, to even come up with a plan?
I think because they are not properly focused.
Oh.
I think they're not properly focused. Yeah, when
so they're not seriously focused on prosperity then? Because well, you can't have prosperity in this environment.
You see, prosperity is a result of progress, meaning activity.
That's
that
point
you
I'm
do
making. Right.
To cause you to progress, that it can give you prosperity. Right. They are starting at the end.
Yes.
Prosperity, speak about prosperity without dealing with the road to get you there.
So that means that they are not serious then?
They are not serious, indeed. Okay. Indeed. And you don't have to take my word for it, gentlemen. The evidence is there.
Yes.
I'm not making this up. I'm only pointing to the evidence.
Yes.
You know, when they have the budgetary expansion over the last 2 years, of over $20 billion
yes.
on the capital side.
Yes.
Where was the focus of that expenditure?
Ships and all.
Ships.
Yes.
And intelligence gathering airplane.
Right.
What I would want to do, if I have a budgetary constraint, I would do what we have successfully done in the past, is to partner with our international partners who have the capability, the capacity, technological capability to assist.
Mm-hmm.
Use that to support beefing up the internal capacities,
like
your intelligence gathering capacities, both in terms of technology and both in terms of even legislation.
Yes.
And I mentioned about legislation. Last year when we didn't vote for the state of emergency, and we had a discussion with the government, one of the things we say to them, look, we are ready to work with you. If there are legislative limitations that the security forces have faced, we will help you identify what you need so far as legislative changes, whether it is amending existing legislation or promulgating new legislation. We stand ready to work with you. We met at Vale Royal on January 7th. And today is July, what?
Ninth. Yes.
6 months exactly. And no more meetings that we have asked for.
Okay.
None. Oh. And you have heard the many pronouncements by Dr. Phillips, the leader of opposition, myself, and other voices from the People's National Party, pleading and begging. We want to work with you.
Yes.
We said to them, look, this thing of fighting crime is not something that can be done by any one government, whether you're a PNP or JLP.
Need the cooperation of all
it's
sectors.
A national problem that we need to get all hands on deck.
Yes.
You can't get all hands on deck, but you want to get as many hands as you can get on deck.
Right.
Let us start with the stakeholders. Let us sit down together, hear from them, hear their views, their perspectives, and most importantly, having determined, having gotten their perspectives,
yes,
let us get some commitment from them in terms of what they can do and prepare to do.
Why do you believe the administration has been reluctant to take that approach?
Because it's a kind of pig-headed approach that the government has.
Okay.
And we saw it in the NIDS.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
We were never against a national identification system. Yes. In fact, it started from our administration.
Yes.
But we said, look, some provisions in this bill, as you had it then, are unconstitutional.
Yes.
We have difficulty with them. Let us sit and iron them out and come to a collective decision. We didn't say no needs, you know.
Yes.
We said we want a constitutional needs.
Yes.
We want a needs that you can live with.
Yes.
So we said subject it to a joint select committee of parliament.
Yes. Yes.
That doesn't only include the opposition.
Yes.
Include other stakeholder groups.
Yeah, I recall that, yes.
Right? The legal fraternity, the human rights fraternity, the church fraternity, the business community. Every single group of Jamaicans who have an interest in this matter.
Right.
Let us hear them, incorporate them, and come up with a legislation. Same approach we are asking them to deal with crime and violence.
So when you say that,
we, the opposition, will be having a crime summit.
Okay.
And we have started to make the preparatory arrangements in place to pull all of those people together and to present to the government and the country what those positions are. That too will form our own approach upon forming government in dealing with the problem, because we don't believe that all the solution resides with us.
Yes. Absolutely. 1 second, Ralston. Mr. Jackson, we have to take a break here on Power Talk Live on Power 106 FM. Of course, part two of the discussion is coming up after the break, because you said that you'd come back to a couple of things, Mr. Jackson. For example, legal support, more legal support for the fight against crime, the idea of strengthened anti-crime legislation. I want to ask you about that and more when we come back on part two of this discussion during Power Talk Live on Power 106 FM and, of course, right on your TV screens on Jamaica News Network as well. We'll be right back. Discussions are very rich this morning on Power Talk Live on Power 106 FM, a matter that affects you, me, all of us, eh? Yeah, as we say in Jamaica, all away. Yeah, the whole issue of how to effectively, not just the deal, how to effectively deal with the scourge of crime. Yes, we have with us the opposition spokesperson on national security. He is Fitz Jackson, of course. Me and Ralston were having some discussions off air as well with the team. And you know, one of the things raised a while ago in terms of why aren't we further down the road in having those mechanisms to fight crime? The will, Fitz Jackson, what say you?
As I said earlier on, I honestly don't believe that the will to confront many of the issues are there within the government, whatever the reasons are. I don't know if it is political or if it is personal, but you know, when criminals are committing acts of criminality against the public, they make no distinction about who you are politically or even socially. They are heartless.
Yes.
They are consumed with their own personal self-interest, and it puts everybody at risk. And I believe that a government, a minister, a prime minister, a MP, must be blind when it comes to those social and political considerations in dealing with the matter. And to give the police force a free rein in apprehending criminals.
Yes.
Criminals. You have a lot of them in St. James, as data already shows.
Yes.
Since the state of emergency over a year ago, what the data also points to is a dispersion of those gang operators across the country.
Yes.
They pop up in other areas.
Mm-hmm.
And that is one of the deficiencies of the state of emergency that we have said from day one.
Yeah.
You have the balloon effect.
Yes.
You squeeze it this side, this end.
Moves to the other side.
It goes to the other side.
Yes.
Criminals behave that way. That's not a new revelation or a discovery.
Yeah.
That's how people behave. Yeah. And we have always said, The state of emergency cannot be the ongoing crime fighting policy. State of emergency is, as the word implies, emergency.
Yes.
And provided for in our constitution, short term.
Yes.
In the first instance, no government can institute it for more than 14 days. Yes. To deal with an emergency, yes. If the situation is beyond that, you can go no longer than 3 months, 90 days.
Right.
Extension so, at a time.
So do you believe that the country and the security forces are now suffering from emergency fatigue?
We are not doubt.
Because when that was announced Sunday morning, I was with some people, and the response was, again?
Mm-hmm. Well, the fatigue come in many different
ways. Yes,
yes. The fatigue is pronounced with the security
correct.
Officers themselves.
Yes.
I have spoken to many of them. Because, you know, as an MP, I represent them too. Soldiers and police live in my constituency.
Right. Yes.
I interact with them as I do right across the country when I travel.
Yes.
Many of them have not seen their families for very, very extended periods of time.
Yes.
Many of them, because of the long hours, particularly the JCF members, more so than the JDF members. The JDF members have easier rotation okay. than the JCF members. And so they work for very long hours and they are beat.
Yeah.
But separate and apart from that, after a while, it becomes a normal activity
yes.
and not an emergency
yes,
activity.
Yes, yes.
I used to complain to the commissioner of police, I stopped doing it now. You drive through many of these checkpoints when you use before the last round. And many of them just stand up
at and the checkpoint,
nobody to check.
Yes, yes.
The chance of being checked is very, very minimal.
Yes.
Yeah,
and that has been widespread.
True. That's true.
The soldiers being out there for extended time, they become like regular persons
yes,
out there.
Yes.
It has lost the shock and awe effect
yes.
that the military presence usually bring to it.
Right.
That right now, when it's a state of emergency, you just said, that's another thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, yes,
so
yes.
It, when a real emergency arises,
precisely,
the impact of the state
will
of
be
emergency
limited.
Is going to be limited.
Yes.
That's right.
We
correct.
Said this from day one.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But many of these things, you know, once you say them as a political representatives, the cynics will say, oh, you're just being political.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
But time has now proven
yes.
virtually everything that
yes.
we have said.
Yes.
And that's the reason why there must be another way and there must be a better way. Let us together identify those better way to do it. I was making the suggestion earlier on about an alternative immediate response in those high crime areas when I mentioned about the task force.
Yes.
You don't have to suspend people's rights and freedom to carry out those activities. In the JCF legislation, you can have curfews.
Yes.
In the areas that you want a particular action to be taken. And you can keep on repeating it for as long as you want to carry out that particular operation.
Okay.
But you simultaneously preserve the rights
of